do. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, thank you for the introduction and welcome to my talk about malware, macOS malware analysis. So first, a small disclaimer. This talk is not about finding bugs in the macOS operating system or writing crazy exploit like we just see in my Teamstar. I will leave that to the other guys. But it's more meant for people who are new to macOS, want to learn something about the operating system from the perspective of a malware analyst, how the kernel works internally, and we will look at some real-world malware samples and behavior patterns. So I'm basically providing you with some context for the talks we just saw, some background information. So first, some words about me. My name is Felix Seeler. I'm a technical lead at VMray, where I'm responsible for the dynamic analysis engine of the VMray malware sandbox. During my master's thesis, I developed the first hypervisor-based macOS malware sandbox, which is now a commercial part as part of the VMray analyzer. And this was my entry into the world of macOS internals. I was a Mac user before. I also created some applications for the iPhone or the Mac. But I never had a look under the hood, how the kernel works, how the system works internally. So I've learned a lot in the past years, and in this talk I want to share some of that knowledge with you and hope you find it interesting. Let's start. So this how is this talk structured? So we will work our way from the very core of the Apple, the XNU kernel, to the outer layers. And we will actually start at the hypervisor level. I want to give you a brief introduction about how hypervisor-based sandboxes work and why we require a very detailed knowledge of the macOS kernel to build a sandbox. And then we look at the macOS kernel itself, how it is structured, some essential primitives, especially inter-process communication. And finally, we will switch to user space, look at some of the built-in security mechanisms provided by Apple to defeat malware, and how we will see how effective they are or not. And finally, I want to give you some practical introduction to macOS malware analysis and show common behavior patterns of real-world malware. Now, let's jump right into it. So to understand why we need such a low-level knowledge of the kernel, I first want to briefly explain how sandboxes work. Usually, malware sandboxes are based on virtual machines. So you set up a VM which closely resembles a machine in your company, for example. You drop a sample into it, let it execute and observe its behavior. Contrary to static AV, this is not based on signatures and heuristics, but you really look at the behavior and judge if it's a malicious sample or not. And the problem is that on the one hand, you don't want any agent in the VM itself. You don't want any monitoring to be present because it could be detected by the malware. But on the other hand, you also have insight into the operating system to see what processes are running and so on. And one way to accomplish this insight into the VM is to use or abuse a feature called second-level page table translation or two-dimensional paging, TDP, and we will see how that works. I will explain it now. So inside a VM, or actually on every regular host, bare metal or VM, we have processes running, and each process has its own virtual address space. And the operating system sets up page tables so that the MMU can translate virtual addresses to physical addresses. And we do this to isolate processes against each other so that they can't access data which they not own. So, but because in a virtualized scenario, we have many VMs running on the same host, and these VMs should not be able to access their memory as well. And they also should not be able to access the host memory. So they can't be allowed to access host memory directly. So what we do to mitigate this, we introduce another set of page tables. They're called the second level page tables. They are created and managed by the hypervisor, and they map the memory which the guest sees as physical to the real physical memory of the host. The second level page tables look very similar to the regular page tables you know, and they also have permission bits. So, for example, in here we have a page which is mapped readable and executable, which is usually the case for code sections. And this page is executable in both the VM and in the hypervisor page tables. Well, now if we remove the executable bit in the hypervisor, what happens now if a program inside the VM tries to execute code on that specific page, this will cause a page fault. And the control will be transferred to the hypervisor. And what this allows us to do is to control the behavior of a sample running inside the VM, which doesn't even know that it's being virtualized, from the outside. And the sample has no way of knowing that it's being monitored, because it can't see these second-level page tables. They're completely outside the VM, and it also doesn't see that this page fault was triggered. For the VM, it just looks like a regular execution. But now, if we're in the hypervisor, we know that the sample tried to execute a specific code. We can check which function was called, extract the parameters, and so on. But how can we use this primitive to effectively analyze samples? And we use a technique called intermodular transition monitoring. And so let's suppose we have a process running, and in the process address space is the sample itself, but also all the third-party libraries or the system libraries and the kernel as well. And now what we do, we divide the virtual memory address space into two sets. First is the target executable, and the second set is all the different libraries and the kernel itself. And now we configure our hypervisor in a way that at every point in time, only one of these sets is executable. So, for example, when we start the sample, we set the sample to be executable. It might do some initialization, some unpacking, deobfuscation, whatever. We're not interested in that. We will just let it run. But as soon as the instruction pointer leaves the executable part, so as soon as the sample does a function call, this will trigger a page fault, and we will be notified in the hypervisor. And then we can see, okay, it called a specific function at this address. We can extract the parameters, and so on. And then we will switch sets. We will make the libraries executable. They may do some internal calls, might call low-level libraries, might even do syscalls. But again, we don't really care about the internals. We already know which function was called, and we don't care about how this function works internally. We already know everything we want. We just let it run. And as soon as the function returns, this triggers a page fault again. We can extract the return value, and the same thing starts over again. So this is the basic idea. But what we now need is to, how do we get the information out of the system? Because we don't have any monitoring, we don't have any agent inside the system, but we still need to get all the information about processes, address space, and so on. And this is called VMI, or virtual machine introspection, and it's the process of reconstructing the state of the guest just from looking at memory. Because from the hypervisor, we see all the guest memory, but we can't execute any code. So we need to know how the kernel manages processes, threads, how it creates the virtual address space, and many, many more things. Everything which we want to include in our analysis, we need to figure out how it's implemented in the kernel. And this is why we need such a deep knowledge of the kernel. This is why this is sort of the motivation of the introduction of this talk. Because for building this, we need to know how the kernel works, how the structs look like, and so on. So yeah, let's have a look at the kernel itself. We've already seen a similar picture today before in a previous talk, but yeah, the kernel is macOS kernel is called XNU. It was originally developed for the NextStep OS, which was later bought by Apple, and it's divided into two main parts. So first we have the Mach layer. Mach is the foundation. It provides the most basic functionality of an operating system, like scheduling, virtual memory, and also inter-process communication. And on top, we have BSD. Sorry, I forgot one thing to tell about Mach. Mach was originally designed as a microkernel. So in a microkernel, every subsystem works in a different process, and they all only communicate via messages. But as you could imagine, this turned out to have a too big of an performance impact. So next step, choose the hybrid architecture, where all components are still separated in the code, but they are in the same address space and still communicate via messages. But since they're in the same address space now, these messages don't have to be copied over. They can just access the data directly. On top of Mach, we have the BSD layer. And the BSD layer provides the standard POSIX API, which you know, the Unix process model, and everything else, which makes macOS a POSIX-compliant operating system. Most importantly, it implements many IO parts of the kernel. So the virtual file system and the networking stack are implemented in BSD. We also have IOKit, which is the device driver framework from macOS. And macOS also supports kernel extensions, which can use a limited API of both the BSD and the Mach layer. Although third-party kernel extensions are deprecated since the latest macOS Catalina, and they are being replaced by so-called system extensions, which are running in user space. One nice thing about, on top of the kernel, we have user space, and in user space, we have your standard C libraries, important things like Objective-C runtime, Core Foundation framework, and also some proprietary application frameworks to be able to build your apps. So, for example, the AppKit framework is used to create GUI applications on macOS. And one of the cool things about this is that since the kernel is partly derived from open source software, many parts of it are also open source. And you can download the kernel source code for the Mach and the BSD parts from opensource.apple.com. And even though it's not straightforward, you can actually compile it yourself, do changes to it, and run your own kernel on a machine. IOKit, the framework itself is also open source, but not the drivers which are implemented using IOKit. And of course, the kernel extensions are not open source as well. In user space, all of the standard C libraries and the Core Foundation framework is open source, but everything which is building on top is not. So I encourage you to check it out. Just go to opensource.apple.com. You get a list of all the components in different versions, and you can browse through the source code, and maybe you will find a nice bug in it. This hybrid model that MacXNU uses, the BSD and the Mach layer, is really interesting, in my opinion, and pretty unique. So I want to give you a more detailed example how it looks in practice. Let's have a look at a very basic example. Let's have a look at processes. So, because Mach is managing scheduling and also virtual memory, of course, it has to know about processes. And processes in Mach are called tasks. They don't have a process ID, but they have a list of threads. And because each process needs also a counterpart in the BSD plane. Because in the BSD plane, we have all the standard I/O things implemented, and we have the common info, which you know, like the process ID, user ID. All this is only implemented in BSD. So every process has this opaque pointer, the BSD info pointer, and it points to the corresponding process struct in the BSD layer. And the same is true for threads. And for Mach, these are just opaque pointers because the basic idea was that Mach is always the fundamental base system of an operating system, and you can build your own layer on top, like they did with BSD. Now let's have a look at one of the most important Mach primitives, Mach messages. You already heard a lot of it already today, because it's such an important component of Mach, and it's used for often used for export, but also has a very important role in the system overall. So mock messages are an interprocess mechanism used in both in kernel space and in user space. And the mock message basically just consists of a fixed size header, some metadata, and an opaque binary body. So the structure of the mock body is not defined. It's totally up to the application to define their own format. The two endpoints which send and receive mock messages are called mock ports, and there are essentially message queues. You can think of it a bit like a socket, although there are differences, but you can think of it like this. And ports have associated port rights, and they define who can receive and send messages on these ports. So there's always only one receive write, because the process holding the receive write is considered to be the owner of this port, but there can be multiple send writes. There can also be special rights like send once, which only allows you to send a message once to this port. Regular messages just contain the header and the body, but messages can also be complex, and that means that they can have out-of-line data. For example, you can pass port rights to another process, which will become interesting later, and you can also pass out-of-line and out-of-line data. And actually, this was not I didn't speak with TeamStyle about it, but yeah, I always have this line in here because out-of-line data is used in many kernel exploits. So this is really an important thing to look at, also for exploiting bugs in macOS, because it can be used for heap spraying, as we just saw. To give you more practical examples, what a port looks like and how it works. So actually, all the kernel objects are accessed through ports. So every task, every thread, and even the virtual memory space of a process is represented by a port. And how does it look like? For example, let's suppose we want to change protection settings of virtual memory. There is the VM protect method. And as a first argument, it receives a task. And how do we get the task? We call the task for pit method, supply a pit, and we get something called a task T. So we get this task, and we can change protection method, protection level of memory. But if we look how a task is defined, it's just a type def for machport T. And machport T is for user space, it's just a number, because these ports work similar to, for example, file descriptors. So there, the kernel has a table of open ports for every process and the associated writes. And this index is just this machport is just an index into that table. So for user space, a machport is just a number, and the kernel makes sense of that number by looking the port up in the table. Now, this already seems really complicated, and that's why Apple built multiple frameworks on top of Mach to make it easier for developers to use it. So they have built multiple more high-level frameworks on top of it. We've already heard briefly about MIG, and there's also very important XPC. This is the most recent and most widely used framework on top of mock messages. XPC allows you to pass structured data like arrays or dictionaries, somewhat similar to JSON, via mock messages, and it abstracts away the complexity of the mock messages. There's also even more abstracted is remote procedure calls via XPC. For example, if you have you need to pass untrusted data, you might not want to do this in your privileged system daemon. So what you can do, you can run a unprivileged or less privileged helper process and communicate with the helper process using XPC. And this is very well abstracted from you, so you just use regular function calls, and it looks like you're doing a function call inside your application, but in fact, this function call is serialized, sent over XPC, and executed in the remote process. So, yeah, people build a lot around that, and that's why also many system daemons use XPC under the hood for pretty important things, like, for example, accessing the keychain, or also for communication with LaunchD, which is used to create services. If you want to learn more about it, there's a great talk by Ian Beer about it. He goes into all the different kinds of inter-process communication frameworks and found many bugs in them because they are so complex. And this is also the point I want to make here. So why should we care about map messages? So as we already have also seen today, they're part of almost every iOS or macOS talk because security researchers regularly find bugs in it, or they use map messages to exploit kernel bugs they found in other parts. That's just a random list of some of them, but there are many more which are using MAR either directly or indirectly. For analysts, it's also really important because, as I said, many of the relevant system functionality is implemented with MAR or XPC under the hood. So you want to know about this, you want to know how this works and what malware could do. And the same applies for sandboxes, of course, because you want to monitor these messages because, for example, a sample could just use low-level MAR calls to do something malicious or to create persistence, for example. And as I already told you, like, LaunchD is a very important process in the macOS operating system, or in iOS as well. And this brings us actually to user space. So LaunchD is the first process in user space. It has PID1, and it has a very important role in MAR ports. It has the responsibility to act like a registry to look up MAR ports. Because if you think about it, if you have two isolated processes and they want to talk to each other, A needs a port to speak to B. But how does A get a send write in the first place? How does it communicate with a process it doesn't know and it's not they are not connected yet? This is what LaunchD is for, or one of the responsibilities LaunchD has. So what you can do is you use the bootstrap check-in function, and you can register a server with some label and have it receive messages on this port. And then in the second process, you can look up the service by using the same identifier, and then LaunchD actually takes care of connecting these two processes so that they can talk to each other. And this also means that every process needs to have an initial port to LaunchD, because how would it talk to LaunchD then? And this is called the bootstrap port. It's created upon process creation so that every process can talk to LaunchD to get other ports. LaunchD is mainly responsible, as the name says, for starting other processes. So, for example, it manages launch daemons and launch agents, which is the name for background services on macOS. It's responsible for opening files. So every time in the Finder you click on a document or an application, this is actually launched by LaunchD. And you can also configure it to start on demand. For example, as a crash handler, if you want to have some action happening on mount or some special events, you can also configure it to do that. But let's have a look at launch daemons and launch agents, because they are really relevant for malware analysis. It's the most common persistence technique used by malware. They are defined in a format called plists, which is a it's an XML format, which has been created by Apple to represent structured data. And this is what it looks like. So this is also taken from a malware sample. You first have a label, which is sort of the name of your service. In this case, you see the sample tried to hide itself as some Apple service. You have the binary, which should be executed. In this case, the sample copied itself to a shared hidden folder and is called checksd. So another attempt to hide from analysis software, for example. And there are more attributes which you can set. For example, the run at load attribute. This makes your process or your service being started automatically after boot. So this is a really, this is the most common persistence technique used by malware. Now, let's have a look at some of the security mechanisms which Apple implemented to prevent you being infected. So first, there is System Integrity Protection, SIP, and it was introduced in 2015 with El Capitan. It's also called rootless because it effectively restricts the abilities of the root user. Even as root, you can't do certain things. And there are three main protections implemented by SIP. First is the file system protection. So you can mark directories or files as protected, and then even as root, you can only read them. You cannot write them, you cannot delete them. And this applies for some of the important system directories like /bin or /system. So effectively, first you can't screw up your system because you just can't run /rm/. And also it's bad for malware because they can't replace arbitrary system binaries to persist on the system. You have runtime protections. So with SIP enabled, you can't attach a debugger or inject into system processes. They are protected. And also kernel extensions must be signed with a specific certificate designed or which is applicable for kernel extensions. And so you have to apply for this at Apple specifically if you want to develop kernel extensions. And I think since this is deprecated by now, they probably won't give out any more certificates. SIP can only be disabled by booting into single user mode and running a utility to disable it. So yeah, this is quite effective for protecting against privilege escalation. Because it makes it really hard to escalate from root to kernel if you haven't found any bug in the system. The next stage is Gatekeeper. So Gatekeeper is like the first level of protection against malware. Every time you download a document or an application from the internet, it will have a so-called quarantine attribute set. And when the first time you start the application or you open the document, you will have a dialogue saying you it will check the signature of the file, and if it's valid, it will just warn you, okay, you downloaded this from the internet, do you want to open it? But in case there is no signature or the signature is invalid, it will actually say, yeah, sorry, I can't open this. And it will actually not allow you to open it directly from here. You see it's just an OK button. You can't say, please override, please open it anyway. What you do, you need to right-click it and then click open. So this is to protect inexperienced users from just randomly executing random applications downloaded from the internet. On the other hand, many software developers also distribute their software unsigned. So, as a Mac user, you're still used to this dialogue, and many users will probably still just click it away and open it anyway because they're used to it even by legitimate software. How is Gatekeeper implemented? It's quite big. So you can see it. There's this com.apple.quarantine attribute in the extended attributes of the file system. And if this is set, there's just metadata which application downloaded this file. And if this attribute is set, Gatekeeper will trigger and will check signatures and so on. But very important that this is an opt-in mechanism. So browsers have to set this attribute explicitly on every file they download. And there are some command line utilities for, like curl, for example. They don't set this attribute. So you can still execute applications then. Also built into Gatekeeper is XProtect. And XProtect checks for known malware signatures. So in this dialog, you can see it says Apple checked it for malicious software and none was detected. So They are scanning the binaries for known malware signatures, and if they found a match, they will tell you the file can't be opened, you should move it to the trash. Interestingly, even since Apple knows this is you downloaded malware, they don't tell it. So they just say, okay, this can't be open, maybe it's damaged, just delete it. They don't use the term malware or virus, probably because they won't want to scare the users and they want to preserve the myth that there is no macOS malware. So they just don't, they know it, but they don't tell you. XProtect is implemented using binary signatures. So what you can see here is similar to Jara rules. It's just static binary patterns with some placeholders in between. So it's a very basic mechanism. It works for non-polymorphic samples, but the problem is that the signatures are contained in XProtect are not that many, and updates are coming every few months, so this is not really effective against up-to-date threats and custom malware. Up until the latest version, XProtect was only applied to quarantine files and only at first launch. This changed in the later version, in the latest version, so they noticed that it wasn't really useful until, or not that useful. Now, malicious content scans, so XProtect is done from on all executables, no matter how they are launched and where they are from, and signature checks are still done only in quarantine file. And there's a very important last row, notarization. Notarization is a new thing required by Apple, so nowadays signing your application with a valid certificate is not enough. You have to notarize it. And what this means is that you need to upload your application to Apple. They will run some basic checks, whatever, we don't know what they do, and then they will, in a few minutes, they will return to you like a digital receipt or ticket you can attach to your app to show the OS, okay, this was actually checked by Apple. And since you now have to upload your application, you don't have to just sign it locally, but you have to upload it to Apple, they can build a huge archive of all the software that's running on Macs all over the world. So that gives them a good leverage. Let's see how effective this mechanism is in the future. There's just another tool to protect you against malware. So it's called Malware Removal Tool, MRT. It's also not marketed anywhere. And it's opposed to Gatekeeper, who runs at first launch. It's supposed to scan the system periodically and find malware. Interestingly, it hasn't been used. It has also been used for non-malware. Maybe you remember the Zoom incident last year. There was this conferencing software which had a really serious bug in its client. So just a malicious website couldn't initiate a conference call, and the camera would enable without the user consenting to it or knowing about it. So, and Apple actually pushed the signature for this conferencing client into MRT, and so they basically, by using this, they remotely wiped the software from all of their customers' machines. So it's a powerful mechanism, but also, same with Gatekeeper, the signatures are just updated very infrequently, and in this case, they're also embedded directly in the binary, which is interesting. So it's only, they only use it for very, very, very bad stuff, I would say. Now, yeah, let's have a look at some real-world malware. First, I want to give like a practical introduction to macOS malware analysis and show you some tools which you can use to get into it. So, of course, all your favorite disassemblers like IDA, Radare, Binary Ginger, and so on, they support the macOS binary format. But there's also a popular disassembler among macOS called Hopper. It's popular because it's a native Mac application and has very good support for reversing Objective-C. So many people working on macOS use it. But there are, even without a disassembler, you still have a lot of tools at your tool belt. You can use many of the built-in command line tools, and there are also some third-party command line tools to do basic binary inspection. on the dynamic side, you can use the LLDB debugger. There's a tracing facility built into the macOS kernel called dtrace, so you can use it to trace system calls and file system usage. You can use hooking engines like Frida or third-party monitoring tools, for example, to monitor for persistence or a firewall to monitor for network traffic. And of course, you can also use a sandbox to analyze malware dynamically. Now, I already talked about the macOS binary format, so let's look into it. It's called MachO, and it has a fixed 4-byte metric, which is different for 32 and 64-bit. And MachO files can also be fat. That means that they can contain multiple architectures in one file. But nowadays, since Apple has moved away from 32-bit, obviously, most of the files are just 64-bit only. The structure is pretty simple. There's a fixed size header and then a list of load commands. And load commands are the most important part of the MachO file. They contain information about all the content, about the segments, the sections. They contain information about import and exported symbols, code signing info, and so on. One of the most important programming languages when looking at macOS malware is Objective-C. Objective-C is a very dynamic, object-oriented programming language, and it's a superset of C, which means you can still mix and match Objective-C and C code, which is also something many people do. If they are too lazy to look up the correct Objective-C function, they would just use C because they know it and it's easier for some. This is what Objective-C code looks like. It's a bit weird. The syntax is a bit weird with the brackets, but you can get used to it. And actually, the dynamic, the amount of because Objective-C is so dynamic, it's also a good thing for reversing, because the Objective-C uses a runtime to dispatch all calls. So every time you call a method on an object, this is dispatched through the Objective-C runtime. And for this reason, the runtime must know which classes exist, which methods they have, and so on. So if you write your own application in Objective-C, you write your own classes, the compiler will create some special metadata contained in the data region of the binary, and it will contain information for the runtime about how your classes look like, what functions they have, what the names of the classes is, even the instance variables of the classes will in some cases be inside of this metadata. So this is really cool for reversing, because if you have an unpacked, non-obfuscated sample, you will see the Objective-C functions and classes here, like in this example. Of course, you can still, like the author tried to do here, you can still scramble up the name, so this is just random chars, but the entry points will be there, and in this case, you see also the method names, so you can already guess what this function is doing. Other common programming languages are for example, Swift. Swift is the successor of Objective-C. It makes less heavy use of a runtime, so it's more compiled, like C++, and since Apple pushes it, also some malware samples start to adapt it. Since macOS is a POSIX operating system, Bash is installed by default, or nowadays Z shell. And because malware authors know how a shell works, some use Bash for parts of their malware. A very interesting one is Slayer, which we will look at later. Some also use Python because it's pre-installed on every Mac, and then you have, you can just code Python. It's also maybe easier than native code. Very infrequently, there are some Java samples and some C++ samples. They often use Qt, so the GUI framework, to create portable malware, which can be run on Windows and macOS. Now, I want to show you an example of a very interesting malware which uses Bash heavily, and it also uses Bash in a way to bypass Gatekeeper, actually. So it bypasses some security mechanisms using this. It's called Slayer, and it's an adware discovered in early 2019. Like many adware samples, is disguised as a fake Flash installer. And the interesting thing about it is that instead of a mach-o executable, the entry point is actually just a bash script. So if you double-click, a bash script will be executed, and it looks like this. So what it does, it uses the built-in OpenSSL command line utility to decrypt encrypted blob located into the in the resources directory and pipes it back into bash. Second stage is just another obfuscated bash script, which is again piped into bash. So we are finally at the third and last stage, and this is the interesting code. It first does some triaging, does some fingerprinting, so it retrieves the version, the macOS version installed, generates a unique ID. It retrieves the platform ID. This is a unique ID persistent for this device, so this can be used for fingerprinting, and in a command control server can use it to determine how many unique devices are infected, for example. It then downloads the actual payload using curl and unzips it, makes it executable, and then opens the payload. So because it uses curl, also the quarantine attribute is not set. So in this case, it wouldn't matter anyway, since it already has code execution. So it just could just remove the quarantine attribute after downloading, but it's also an interesting thing. And because bash scripts can't be code signed, the initial execution is also not protected from by Gatekeeper, because there's no signatures to check. It will still have the dialog if you want to open the application, but it won't show invalid signatures, for example. Now, this was a very interesting technique, and it was later used by other adware families in a similar way. Now let's look at another common pattern, privilege escalation. So after gaining initial execution on the system, you usually try to escalate to root for creating privileged service, for example. And it's required to change some global settings, inject into other processes, or install a keylogger. And although security researchers regularly find bugs, some of them are really trivial and almost laughable, still malware authors are not that motivated. Usually they will just use the system API to pop a dialog, which then asks the user to enter his root password. And surprisingly, this works pretty good, because macOS users are used to these dialogs, so they're popping up frequently, and again, this sample tries to disguise as some Apple service, so inexperienced user might actually enter their password here. Another idea is to fake this prompt. So this one is the prompt generated by the system API, but you can also create your own prompt looking exactly like the system API, but then you get the password in plain text. So you can store it, you can use it later on, send it to your C2 server or whatever. So let's have a look at some anti-analysis features. We know some of these already from the Windows world, and they're also starting to slowly get into the macOS world as well. So of course you have some basic techniques like string obfuscation or code obfuscation. Many samples use dynamic address resolution, so similar to on Windows, get proc address and load library, you have dlopen and dlsim to dynamically get addresses of functions. You can deny debugging, you can deny attaching a debugger after application has started using the ptrace command. And this is an example of a sample ransomware which does some of these anti-analysis checks. It first retrieves the current time, then uses dlopen and dlsim to get the handle for ptrace. It calls ptrace with the pt deny attach parameter, and it then gets the time again. So, okay, the ptrace part is clear why the timing checks. So, because if you want to analyze the sample, you can still start the debugger first and let the debugger start the program, because then you can break on ptrace, skip the function or patch the parameter, and it will have no effect. You can still debug it. But it does the time check, because if you attach a debugger and you manually skip the function or overwrite the parameter, this will take some time. So the time difference between this call and this call will be maybe a few seconds, depending on how fast you are, as opposed to immediately if the sample wasn't debugged. So it actually is aware that it still can be debugged, and it's trying to detect the debugger by using timing differences. So, of course, we also see some anti-VM and anti-sandbox techniques, like basic stuff like sleep evasion or timing checks. And also very popular is to check for being analyzed in a virtual machine. So, for example, you can check for the number of cores. You can check for any virtualization artifacts in the hardware registry by trying to detect virtual box drivers and so on. You can also check for the prefix of the MAC address of the Ethernet interface, because it will have some vendor-specific prefix which you can attribute to a virtual machine vendor. And, of course, AV detection. So you have mail samples that check for specific paths of security products, or check the running processes for any known security software. Lately, we've also seen some packed samples. So many of them use UPX, which is a open source packer available for Windows, macOS, and maybe only also Linux, I'm not sure. Some go do a little bit more effort, and they create a custom version of UPX, which can't be unpacked with the stock version, which is cool. There's also VMProtect, the popular packer from the Windows world, now supporting macOS, even though I haven't seen a sample using it in a while, so let's see. And very rarely we see some custom packers. And I want to show you an example of a custom packer which has been called in the wild. This is from the install call. It's also, again, address sample. And if you load the application up in IDA, and the entry point is somewhere here, you see there's one instruction which could be valid, but the rest is just garbage. So, yeah, this looks like an obfuscated sample. But if you run the executable, it still works. Even though the entry point is garbage, it still executes fine. How did they do it? And you might wonder, and as I said, nice thing about Objective-C is that it will turn up in the symbol table. And if we look closely in the function window of IDA, we see that there are some Objective-C functions. And two of them actually are called load. And these load functions are special functions. They're called initializers, and they are called by the runtime before the entry point is executed. So you can use this to run code before the actual entry point to do deobfuscation. And this is exactly what they did. If you look at the second of these load methods, you can see a routine which looks like this. So we have some input bytes, we have a loop, and then we have output. And this looks like a pretty standard deobfuscation routine. So let's look at it in debugger. And yes, if we look at the memory area, after each iteration, one byte is patched with a fixed XOR key. And this what comes out of this is what looks like an ASCII encoded 128 decryption key. So it's an interesting choice to encode it into ASCII, but why not? And this key is then fed into a much larger decryption routine. And somewhere in that decryption routine, there's a call to VMProtect. So as we already saw, VMProtect can be used to change the memory permissions of virtual memory. And in this case, they're setting it to... they're sending it to 7, yeah. So they're setting it to readable, writable, and executable to be able to unpack their code into executable memory. And if we skip behind this obfuscation routine and look at the entry point again in the debugger, yes, we see it has been decrypted and now it contains valid information. So, this is an example of a more invasive, more difficult to reverse engineer malware because it uses custom packer, custom deobfuscation. This is actually the output of the ReML analyzer because Sandbox is basically the perfect way to analyze such a sample because, as I already told you, we just let the sample run. So if it has heavy obfuscation, we will just let it deobfuscate itself and we can dump the memory of the unpacked executable afterwards. So what you can see here is actually we only, in the sandbox, we only see the VM protect call. And afterwards, we already see all the function calls of the initialization of the runtime. So this is already sample code. So we don't see all the decryption and the deobfuscation. It's just the calls made by the sample. And we can also dump the memory and get the unpacked executable afterwards. So if you want to learn more about this, there's also a talk about, I think not this particular sample, but a very similar sample by a Sophos researcher. So there's a link below if you want to read more about it. Cool. That's it for my talk. So I hope you got the impression that it's worth also looking beyond the Windows world into macOS operating system. I personally think that the architecture of the macOS kernel is pretty interesting and unique. And as you may also notice, it's a common theme that the built-in security provided by Apple is, I wouldn't say useless, but it's not that effective. It was improved by in the latest operating system version by adding more checks, but still these signatures lag behind, so they are not a real good protection against live threats or targeted threats. macOS malware has become more sophisticated in the last years by, for example, using more techniques from the Windows world, but it's still very basic in other regards. For example, privilege escalation. Until now, we haven't seen using the abuse of bugs to escalate privileges. It's mostly just ask the user, and they will give you the password. And also, as you may have noticed, many of the more sophisticated samples were actually adware samples. So this has become a common theme. These adware families are on the rise. There seems to be a lot of money in it. So they have a lot of money to invest into developers. And these samples are actually pretty sophisticated as opposed to the regular malware. Cool. Yeah, that's it from my side. Thank you for your attention. If you want to learn more about it, ask now or come to me later. Yeah. Are there any questions? There's one.
Who has the question? Just showed that the slides related to the entry point. I mean, like you said about packing and unpacking. Can you just tell more about it? Like, how do you basically identify which unpacking thing to use, unpacker to use?
Okay. Yeah. So you just open it up, or do we mean the basic process of how to analyze this kind of samples? Yeah. So the entry point is just you just open it up first, and you see, okay, this can't be executed like this. So the sample, if it just jumps into the entry point, it will crash. It doesn't work. So there has to be some way that they're executing code before the entry point. And then you need to think about methods how they can achieve that. So you look at the mach headers. There are different metadata fields where initializers can be registered. and also these Objective-C initializers, and then you know, okay, there, let's try set a breakpoint there. And then you go into the debugger and go into these functions and step through them to see what they're doing. And then you, if you see such a loop like this, you already know, okay, this sounds, this looks like some deobfuscation. And then you need to try to figure out what the end of this deobfuscation routine is. Try to find the right address to set a breakpoint, and then validate your assumption to check if the entry point was actually decrypted.
So it's basically the initialization function, right? I mean that.
I'm sorry, I didn't get it.
So it's basically we have to deobfuscate the initialization function, right?
Yes, we have to find them. So some, like the entry point, the very first entry point can't be obfuscated because it has to run. So you have to find some code which is not obfuscated, which looks like something that could be a deobfuscation routine. Yeah.
Do we have more questions?
Yeah. So now that you mentioned that, I mean, so there are malwares on macOS are on the rise, but they are not that sophisticated. And the protection that is provided by the platform is for now rudimentary. So is there any recommendation as to how to protect if that given protection is not enough?
Yes, I can do have some recommendations. There's a great suite of tools created by a guy called Patrick Wardle. He has some third-party security tools. For example, they will monitor for persistence, for example. So every time any process creates a new persistent service, you will be notified, like a firewall for persistence, basically. So when you infected yourself, you will see that, okay, some process just tried to install a service, and if it's not legitimate, you should better have a look into it. And the same, he also has for like a firewall. Firewall is already also a very good thing. Little Snitch or Lockblock, I think it's called, the free variant. You will see network traffic by the malware, and if you have some suspicious process, better check it. So yeah, the general recommendation is to first, of course, common sense. Don't download any applications. Don't follow any instructions telling you to disable mitigations. Just use your common sense, and then also have like some third-party monitoring tools installed.
Okay. One more question. So, like the Slayer, right? It uses Bash.
Yeah.
So, I mean, to protect something like that, Windows introduced signing PowerShell scripts.
Mm-hmm.
So, is there something going on in by Apple as well to sign those scripts?
I'm not aware of it, no. So, there's something called AppleScript, and I think these AppleScripts, they can be signed, but I'm not aware that Bash scripts can be signed, no.
Oh, thank you.
Hello. You mentioned multiple file types of malwares, right? How common are the malwares that are compiled from C? So you mentioned that there are generic frameworks supported by Mac, which usually developers use. But
yeah.
But C can also be used, for example, compilers provided by default. So how common are malwares built using C?
Yes, there are some samples which are purely written in C because Objective-C is not complex, but it's hard to get into at the beginning. So if you are malware alpha, you want to move to a new system, want to produce malware fast, and don't want to spend the time get into Objective-C, you can just use C, and it's actually, it's common, yeah.
Do we have more questions? Okay, thank you, Felix.
Thank you.